Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Sir, good morning, sir. Sir, Professor Pandey, sir.
अरे अविनाश जी, गुड मॉर्निंग। अच्छे हैं आप।
उनको म्यूट करो, अनम्यूट करो ना। प्रोफेसर पांडे को अनम्यूट करें।
गया।
हाँ सर, वो सर तो
नमस्कार
अनम्यूट
सर, अविनाश।
नमस्कार नमस्कार सर, कैसे? अच्छे हैं आप?
हम ठीक है सर। सो नाइस ऑफ यू कि हम लोग की आपने
अरे
रिक्वेस्ट मान ली और इस बीच।
बहुत दिन से वो था आपके पास आने का, लेकिन वो हो ही नहीं रहा है।
बीच में तो कोरोना भी आ गया था। इट्स अनदर
वही
अकाउंट।
तो।
तो सर
चलिए।
आप अगर आप जुड़ गए हैं तो हम अपना टाइम थोड़ा कम कर देंगे सो दैट द स्टूडेंट्स कैन
नहीं
बेनिफिटेड
नहीं
बाय।
नहीं 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 आप अपना पूरा समय लीजिए, मुझे
नहीं, हमारा तो
आपको
केवल ये था ना कि चूंकि हम होस्ट हैं तो हम अपने फैसिलिटीज के बारे में परिचय कराते हैं बच्चों से, तो आई कैन डू इट क्विकली।
हाँ
तो उसके बाद फिर आपसे आपको
नहीं
बोलेंगे।
ठीक
जी
है। हाँ, 1 घंटे का समय मेरे लिए है, काफी है।
जी जी जी
40-45 मिनट करूंगा, फिर इंटरेक्शन के लिए छोड़ दूंगा।
ठीक ठीक बात जी। कैसे
गुड।
हैं आप सर? ठीक ठाक वहां पर?
हाँ
अच्छा
सर, शैल वी स्टार्ट?
अभिषेक, आई नीड टू बी लाइक आई हैव टू शेयर द स्लाइड सो दैट आई कैन शो माई फैसिलिटीज। दैट पार्ट इज नॉट एनेबल्ड फ्रॉम माई
सर
साइड, सो
सर
काइंडली मेक।
आई या श्योर श्योर सर।
सो स्टिल 2 मिनट्स आर लेफ्ट, वी कैन वेट।
हाँ ओके ओके। आपकी इलाहाबाद की लैब ठीक ठाक चल रही है?
नहीं सर, लैब नहीं, बंद, लगभग बंद हो गई है।
अच्छा
वो असल में ट्रांजिशन था ना, तो देर वॉज नो वाइस चांसलर फॉर 1 ईयर।
अच्छा
द एक्सीलरेटर विच वॉज देयर, इट हैड सम लाइक एक फाल सीलिंग टूट गई ऊपर, सोर्स के ऊपर।
ओहो
आई विल डिस्कस यू इन डिटेल,
ओहो
क्योंकि इश्यूज जो होता ना कि इमीडिएटली आई हैव टू एड्रेस द रिक्वायरमेंट
हाँ
इंस्ट्रूमेंट विच इज नॉट देयर।
हाँ
तो हम
अच्छा
लोग ने एक बात की थी कि एक अपना जो होता है ना कि एक्सटेंडेड कैंपस के तौर पर IUAC का, और हैड अ गुड डिलीबरेशन जिसमें वो भी आए थे, आदित्य केलकर भी आए थे, तो जोशी कमिटी वाज देयर। सो हाउ टू हेल्प द एक्सेलरेटर्स एंड अदर फैसिलिटीज विच आर देयर इन द यूनिवर्सिटीज वेयर द वर्कशॉप फैसिलिटीज एंड अदर थिंग्स आर नॉट।
हाँ
तो वो
हाँ
कंपनी के रिकमेंडेशन उनके पास पड़ा हुआ है UGC
हाँ
में, और अभी चूंकि ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन चल रहा था फ्रॉम जी। नाउ वी कैन स्टार्ट सर, आई विल
ओके
गेट
ओके ओके
जी।
सर, कैन यू शेयर योर स्क्रीन नाउ सर?
यस आई शेयर।
ओके ओके सर, शैल आई स्टार्ट नाउ?
यस
वेल नमस्कार। राष्ट्रीय विज्ञान दिवस के अवसर पर आयोजित इस ऑनलाइन कार्यक्रम में आप सबका हार्दिक स्वागत है। गुड मॉर्निंग एंड ए वेरी वार्म वेलकम टू ऑल ऑफ यू इन दिस ऑनलाइन प्रोग्राम ऑन द ओकेजन ऑफ द नेशनल साइंस डे। इन द पास्ट ईयर्स ऑन दिस डे वी हैव बीन इनवाइटिंग अंडर ग्रेजुएट स्टूडेंट्स, फिजिक्स स्टूडेंट्स टू आवर सेंटर हियर इन दिल्ली टू अटेंड द प्रोग्राम इन पर्सन, एंड दीज स्टूडेंट्स जनरली बिलोंग टू द कॉलेजेस इन एंड अराउंड दिल्ली। हाउएवर ड्यू इन दिस ईयर ड्यू टू द प्रिवेलिंग कोविड-19 पैंडेमिक इन द वर्ल्ड, द प्रोग्राम इज बीन कंडक्टेड इन एन ऑनलाइन मोड। This, however, has its own benefits in the sense that we have increased our outreach, and this year students from all across the country have registered for the program. I am very happy to inform you that we have got more than 600 registrations from all over India, and more than 300 people have already joined the present the program. I also wish to inform you that this program is being streamed live on YouTube, and it is available through the link which is given on the slide that is on display. Now, without any further delay, I would like to invite our director, Professor Avinash Chandra Pandey, for his opening remarks on the significance of the National Science Day and a brief overview of the various facilities, experimental facilities available at IUAC. I must request all the participants to kindly turn off their videos. This will allow for a smoother streaming. Sir, please.
So, am I visible now? And sir, my slides?
I just stopped video. Share kaise unshare karenge? So unshare kar.
I have shared the slides.
Yeah, we can see it.
जी तो आपको आज विज्ञान दिवस पर बहुत बहुत शुभकामनाएं और सबसे बड़ी खुशी की बात हमारे साथ ये है कि हमारे साथ जो हमारे आज मुख्य वक्ता हैं प्रोफेसर एचसी वर्मा जी वो जुड़े हुए हैं और आज का जो कार्यक्रम है वो जहाँ तक मेरा प्रसंग है तो हम आपको अपनी सुविधाओं जो हमारे इस सेंटर पर है उसके बारे में बताना होगा। अच्छा होता कि आप लोग हमारे कैंपस में आए होते लेकिन आप जानते हैं कि इस वैश्विक महामारी के कारण यह संभव नहीं हो सका। सो वी हैव चेंज द एंटायर सॉर्ट ऑफ सेटअप इन सच ए मैनर दैट वी कैन रीच लार्ज नंबर ऑफ यंग स्टूडेंट्स अक्रॉस द कंट्री। सो इट इज अ ब्लेसिंग इन डिसगाइज ऑल्सो बिकॉज अर्लियर वी ओनली यूज टू इन्वाइट द स्टूडेंट्स ऑफ दिल्ली यूनिवर्सिटी फ्रॉम नियर बाई कॉलेजेस but this time we are able to reach a large number of students from all over the country.
Sir, so sir isko thoda sa I request to full screen kar lijiye sir ye
mere upar to full screen dikh raha hai
nahi sir idhar nahi aa raha hai full screen ye us mode mein hi aa raha hai ha ab aa raha abhi aaya tha sir
aa gaya acha
nahi abhi fir chala gaya hai beech mein aaya tha again it has gone
ab
nahi
ye
आता है सर बट फिर चला जाता है।
ये तो हम जब प्रेजेंटर मोड से जैसे ही करते हैं वो मेरी पूरी स्क्रीन जो है वो आच्छादित हो जाती है विद दिस और इफ आई सो हाउ टू डू इट वो चेंज हुआ
सर वो
कम हुआ है उसको श्रिंक किया क्या बात ने
सर
बॉटम बॉटम प्याला जैसा बना है ये वाला हाँ राइट
जी वो करने के बाद ऐसे होता है फिर हो गया
ठीक है
तो शुरू करें सर इज नॉट गुड और व्हाट शुड आई डू
नहीं सर ठीक है आप कंटिन्यू कर लीजिए सर
अच्छा तो इस संस्थान की जो स्थापना थी द सेंटर वॉज एस्टैब्लिश्ड इन वे बैक इन 1985-84। हमारे सामने दो फंडामेंटल क्वेश्चंस हैं। पहला प्रश्न ये है कि इस ब्रह्मांड का विस्तार क्या है और दूसरा बिल्डिंग ब्लॉक क्या है। एक माइक्रोस्कोपिक वर्ल्ड है और दूसरा मैक्रोस्कोपिक वर्ल्ड है। तो माइक्रोस्कोपिक वर्ल्ड में इस एलिमेंट जो जो हमारे पास बिल्डिंग ब्लॉक क्या है उसके बारे में जानना जो संक्रियाएं हैं जो डिफरेंट काइंड ऑफ रिएक्शंस हैं उनको जानने के लिए हमारे पास ये सुविधा इंटर यूनिवर्सिटी एक्सेलर सेंटर जिसका नाम पहले न्यूक्लियर साइंस सेंटर था उसकी स्थापना हुई और साथ ही साथ पुणे में इंटर यूनिवर्सिटी सेंटर फॉर एस्ट्रोनॉमी एंड एस्ट्रोफिजिक्स की स्थापना हुई। ये फुल स्क्रीन नहीं आ रहा है तो पूछ लीजिए
सर आशीष इज कमिंग उसको एक्चुअली सर पहले फुल स्क्रीन करके फिर शेयर करना है।
इसको क्या करें पहले
सर आशीष इज कमिंग टू योर ऑफिस
ठीक है स्टॉप शेयरिंग
हाँ सर इसको फुल स्क्रीन करके फिर दोबारा शेयर करना पड़ेगा।
शेयरिंग कहाँ से होगा ये शो प्रेजेंटर व्यू अब
किया
आपको सर पूरा ऐसे सेंड करना पूरा।
इसको बंद कर दें
इसको सर, हाँ इसको पूरा आपको सेंड करना है राइट।
नहीं रुकिए,
अभी आ गया सर, नाउ इट इज फुल स्क्रीन।
ठीक है
बस
जी, अब ठीक है सर
सर
अभिषेक?
अभी, हाँ सर अभी बीच में दिखा था सही हो गया था, अभी मिनिमाइज हो गया है। हाँ
शेयर करिए सर फिर।
स्टॉप शेयरिंग है ना
जी
हाँ सर अभी आ गया। यस
सो सॉरी फॉर दिस, देयर मेनी प्लेटफॉर्म्स एंड वी कीप ऑन शिफ्टिंग फ्रॉम वन प्लेटफॉर्म, सो दिस इज वन सच इशू व्हिच जनरली कम्स। सो नाउ कमिंग टू दिस पार्ट, यू नो दैट द एलिमेंट्स विच आर देयर इट ऑल कॉन्स्टिट्यूट्स एवरीथिंग, चाहे वो पूरी दुनिया हो, सन हो, हम लोग हो, एलिमेंट्स से मिलके बने हुए हैं। और वी ऑल्सो नो दैट दिस इज वॉट द कंप्राइजेज ऑफ, एंड दिस हैज बीन काइंड ऑफ इंटरेस्ट फ्रॉम वेरी बिगिनिंग। जो फिलासफर्स थे जिनका रोल बाद में साइंटिस्ट ने ले लिया, और मेरा यहाँ पर तात्पर्य यह है कि वी शुड ऑलवेज थिंक एंड रीड द ओल्ड थिंकर्स, द फिलोसफीज, फिलासफर्स, हाउ दे स्टार्टेड थिंकिंग अबाउट द यूनिवर्स एंड वॉट वेयर देयर प्रिलिमिनरी थिंग्स ऑफ वे ऑफ अंडरस्टैंडिंग। So now you know that many such elements are there which are populated in periodic table. Here with the accelerators, it is very simple idea. What we do, we take the smallest possible particle and give them the highest possible energy, which is the crux of accelerating system here. And you might have also come to know that many such accelerators there in world. You might have also gone through the news which was there with the Large Hadron Collider. So this is one such accelerator facility here in India, which is used by extensively by our researchers, our scientists in the country. And many such issues are there that are related to the evolution of universe, how to handle some of the problems. So we do cater to a minuscule of some of the problems here in our center. So what we do, why we need accelerators? So you know that the particles behave like waves, and physicists, they use accelerators to increase a particle's momentum. We, in a way, we decrease the wavelength, and then we can go inside the atoms. So the way we send the Voyager and other Chandrayaan, Mangalyaan, hum universe mein bhejte hain, usi tarah se ye yaan hai jo ki inside एटम्स और सब एटॉमिक पार्टिकल्स को जा करके देख करके उसके बारे में आपको इन्फॉर्मेशन देते हैं। सो दैट इज वॉट इज रिक्वायर्ड टू अंडरस्टैंड मोर इन डिटेल। सो द सेकेंड इंपॉर्टेंट थिंग इज द एनर्जी ऑफ स्पीडी पार्टिकल्स इज यूज टू क्रिएट द मैसिव पार्टिकल्स, एंड दैट समटाइम्स फिजिसिस्ट ऑल्सो वॉन्ट टू स्टडी, एंड दिस इज वॉट यू कुड सी बाई सिंपल स्कीमेटिक, यू नो ई इज इक्वल टू एम सी स्क्वायर। एंड With why we do science, why we celebrate this Science Day, we know that the expectations from the young generation, which is sitting here in audience, the expectations are we should have safe and abundant food supplies, we should have sustainable and benign energy sources, we should affect the we should have effective management of disease and aging. You might have come to know during this pandemic that the entire healthcare system was challenged. And we in India came out with the vaccines, and also we tried to find out ways by which we can save ourselves and many aging population. Likewise, if we can have some idea by which we can perfect this self-reproduction technologies with minimum energy consumption, that will be boon for the society. Then again, advanced computing system, which has now come to a kind of again breakthrough is required. From a viewpoint of quantum computing, we have to work hard to understand many of the things in that sense. This is one such quote which I have taken here. One thing is sure, that earth is more cultivated and developed now than ever before. There is more farming, but fewer forests. Swamps are drying up, and cities springing up on an unprecedented scale. So our earth planet on which we live is also under stress. And that is not the concern which we have raised now. It was in 200 BC also, people were worried about the extra, or you can say the exploitation of the earth or the mother earth, which was always a matter of concern. So always we have to find solutions using science to make our environment better. And that is another concern which I need to flag on this day. You know why we are celebrating this Raman effect was observed on 28th February, and it got announced on 29th February on that day. We now have got an opportunity in New Education Policy that we will be having multidisciplinary interfaces, and we should always think of having a good collaborations by which we can actually solve the real problems, which should not have kind of silo way of understanding the problem and working in isolation. So this is another avenue which is coming very soon in the education system. Coming to our facilities which we have, we started with this Pelotron, which was further augmented with the LINAC, and in a journey of 30 years, three decades, we added many accelerators, including RBS facility, dedicated AMS facility, SNCS, positive ion source, and also a tabletop accelerator system was also built here, fabricated, so that the PG departments of other universities can also get benefited by having this kind of accelerator system there. This is our growth in the last 30 years. You know, you could see from here that almost all the universities, those who have vibrant physics departments, they have good connect with us. And this has started rising just after the facility was thrown open, and it has keep continuing. You could see the colleges, universities, institutes, they are our ambassadors. They work here, they publish paper, the students are trained, the capacity is built in this area. And we also get some publications, which is generally considered as one of the success stories. During that part, which was actually this 2020, we started reaching people through this blended mode, through this online mode. And we also organized many such events, even though the colleges were closed and the academic activity was at its lowest. So this is the 15 UD Pelotron, which was only closed for a while when the complete lockdown was there. After that, we started operations, and we started inviting samples from across the country to keep ourselves busy and also get some of the things done with whatever resources we have here. This is another addition to our Pelotron, and now it is going to get operated very soon for catering to the needs of nuclear physics experiments. This is a schematic. If you would have come to this center, you would have visited these areas where the different beam lines and different facilities are situated. I can only give a glimpse. And this is another accelerating system which is being added, and that is called high current injector. You could see this in the process of getting integrated to the system so that we can supply energetic high current particles to the main LINAC. We also do several such in-house developments. Production is there, and we cater to the requirements of technological obsolescence. We keep on improvising some of the things, so the students do get an opportunity to interact with our people when they have to do some project work, so that they can also understand different kind of electronic systems, different kind of control systems. So that is another opportunity for the students to interact with our scientists here. This is another area in which we have started working, and that is National Geochronology Facility, which is being set up with all kind of facilities which are required to date a sample, which may be few thousand years to million years and billion years. And this is another laboratory which is being extensively used by geologists and geophysicists across the country. We have set up high resolution SIMS, which is being made operational, and it will be good to know that this is one such facility which is there in our entire subcontinent, unique in its sense. These are some of the facilities which are exclusively used for nuclear physics experiments. We have classified Indian gamma array, neutron detection array, HIRA, HIRA, hybrid recoil mass analyzer, and heavy ion reaction analyzer. So if you have, you wish to have any interest in nuclear physics, this is one such place where you can definitely work and definitely get your ideas implemented. There are limitations, but definitely you can start pursuing, you can start interacting with the people to know how you can align with the facilities with your objectives. The other big group is material science, where all such kind of characterization facilities, in situ characterization facilities are available. And this is a glimpse of such facilities which are populated in this center at several places. The other important thing which is being added, and that is Delhi Light Source, which will be free electron laser based source. We'll have electron beam as well as terahertz radiation, and the experimental facility shall be set up very soon to attract the researchers who have any plans with any of these two beams. So this is what we have in material science. Sorry, I'm going back. So besides this, we also started working on some of the key technological developments. And key technological development, you might be surprised to know that till date, we don't have any such facility where we can fabricate Raman spectrometer inside country. We do not fabricate the MRI machine. We all import from different places. So the government of India is now taking this as a serious note, and you might have read in many newspapers that you should be vocal for local. You should also go for Atmanirbhar, self-reliant. And in that area, we have joined hands with the CDAC under the aegis of MIT, Government of India, to develop one MRI machine here to understand the intricacies so that it can be upscaled and it can be manufactured in the country. And that is what the significant step which we have taken. We have got a good progress in this direction, and we hope that very soon we'll be coming with a machine which is indigenously developed with some support from outside. So that is, and there are many byproducts. When we develop something, you also learn a lot, and you develop these are the power supplies, these are the magnetic ramping unit, which we have developed here, which we are trying to understand. And in that process, we also have some intellectual property, which has been filed to get patented. This is what I wanted to share, and I did not want to take much of time because हमारे साथ हमारे बहुत valuable हमको पिछले कई वर्षों से कोशिश कर रहे थे कि हमारे साथ प्रोफेसर वर्मा जी जुड़े और हमारे विद्यार्थियों को आज के समय में जो पढ़ाई केवल डिग्री प्राप्त करने तक ही सीमित ना हो और पढ़ाई ऐसी होनी चाहिए जिससे कि हम देश के लिए कुछ कंट्रीब्यूट कर सकें. हमारे अंदर जो ऊर्जा है और वो ऊर्जा क्रिएटिविटी सृजनात्मक क्षमता जो हमारे अंदर है उसको कहीं से कोई किरण मिल सके जिससे कि वो स्पार्क दिखे. विद्यार्थी अभी तक हमने अभी जो बताया लास्ट की स्लाइड्स में कि हम लोग अभी आत्मनिर्भर बनने की दिशा में अग्रसर है. आत्मनिर्भर हम तभी बन सकते हैं जब हमारी शिक्षा व्यवस्था ऐसे विद्यार्थियों को आगे लाए जो इस तरह के चैलेंजेस ले सकें और चीज़ों को अच्छे से समझ करके उसके जो भौतिकी के कंसेप्ट्स को समझ करके उनको उत्पाद के रूप में लाने के लिए अपना बहुमूल्य समय दे सके, बजाय कि शिक्षा को केवल अर्थ के इकोनॉमिक एक्टिविटी केवल अपने आय को बढ़ाने का स्रोत ही नहीं होना चाहिए बल्कि देश के हित में कुछ काम हो सके इस दिशा में भी कार्य होना चाहिए, और वैज्ञानिकों के ऊपर बहुत बड़ी भूमिका है उनकी जो इस दिशा में अच्छा काम कर सकते हैं। इन्हीं शब्दों के साथ हम आपको ले चलते हैं अपने आज के सम्माननीय मुख्य वक्ता प्रोफेसर एच सी वर्मा जी के पास।
थैंक यू सर, थैंक यू फॉर योर एनलाइटनिंग रिमार्क्स एंड अ कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव ओवरव्यू ऑफ दी फैसिलिटीज इन द सेंटर। आई एम श्योर दैट योर इंट्रोडक्शन टू द वेरियस फैसिलिटीज विल एनेबल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स टू appreciate the virtual lab tour that we have organized at the end of the program. Thank you once again. We have today with us eminent physicist and Padma Shri Professor Harish Chandra Verma, who has kindly consented to deliver the keynote lecture on this occasion. We welcome you, sir, to the program.
Oh, thank you.
Professor Verma doesn't need an introduction, as most of us are familiar with his name. We have watched his educational videos which are available online, or we have read several of the books which have been authored by him, and one of the most popular one being The Concepts of Physics at 10 plus 2 level, which I have also read. Nevertheless, it will be my privilege to give a brief introduction of his works and achievements. Professor Harish Chandra Verma was a professor in Department of Physics at Indian Institute of Technology Kanpur till 2017. And prior to joining IIT Kanpur, he was a faculty at the Science College, Patna University for 15 years from 1979 to 1994. His research interests include nanofabrication using focused ion beams, magnetism in graphite on irradiation by ion beam, and nano-sized magnetic materials. He has published 139 research papers in reputed journals and is the author of several books in physics at school and college levels. He has developed more than 300 physics experiments, which can be used by teachers as demonstrations in their classrooms. He has also produced a set of 45 lectures in Hindi at school level. Professor Verma is an executive committee member of the Indian Association of Physics Teachers, which works for physics education in schools and colleges. He has been associated with several social causes also, and has been instrumental in making a group of IIT Kanpur faculty members and students together with local youth to run an NGO called Shiksha Sopan through various centers in villages around IIT Kanpur. Shiksha Sopan provides educational support to around 250 economically weaker families, and it also runs various scholarship programs which helps poor children to continue education. Professor Verma was awarded the Maulana Abul Kalam Shiksha Puraskar by the Bihar State Government in 2017. And in 2020, he was awarded the Padma Shri by the Government of India. With these words, I'd like to invite Professor Verma to deliver his lecture. I would like to mention here that we can take a few questions at the end of the lecture from the participants. And I request all participants to kindly type their questions in the chat box, and we can take them up. Depending upon the time availability. Sir, please.
So thank you, Abhishek ji, for this nice introduction of mine. And thank you, the director, Dr. Avinash Pandey ji, for setting the stage. It's true that why science? First, why education and why especially science? And you have very rightly said that all the problems of the world which we face, mankind face, the science has the key. If you know the principles of science, if you know how the nature works and what are the kind of interactions at the macro scale and at the micro scale, then we can develop solutions of our problems. So ant mein jo apne science ka zimmedari hai, वो जिम्मेदारी ये बनती है कि जिस भी तरह की समस्याओं से मनुष्य जूझता है तो उनका निदान करना, और नहीं भी समस्याएं हो तो भी इससे बेहतर क्या दुनिया हो सकती है उसके लिए चीज़ों को तैयार करना, उस तरीके से चलना। तो ये एक साइंस की बड़ी जिम्मेदारी है। और हमारे एजुकेशन सिस्टम के अंदर में हम लोग बहुत बचपन से साइंस को पढ़ाते हैं, पढ़ते हैं, लेकिन इस जिम्मेदारी के साथ कनेक्शन जो जो वास्तव में संसार है हमारा, द वर्ल्ड इन विच वी आर लिविंग, द लाइफ दैट वी आर लिविंग, द कनेक्शन ऑफ साइंस विद दैट वर्ल्ड एंड दैट लाइफ, दैट इज मेनी टाइम्स मिसिंग इन आवर स्कूल कॉलेज सिस्टम. ये जब हो जाता है तब, जैसे आप कह रहे थे अभी, कि जो शिक्षा का उद्देश्य है, द गोल, द टारगेट इज देन कि कैसे नौकरी मिलेगी, कैसे हम अपना कुछ कर सकेंगे, कैसे हम ज्यादा पैसे कमा सकेंगे, मेरा घर कैसे चलेगा, ये फिर उसके लिए तैयारी हो जाती है. सारा पढ़ना लिखना किस लिए है कि पढ़ेंगे लिखेंगे नहीं तो खाएंगे क्या, है ना. तो ये जो एक गैप है अपने सोच में और अपनी शिक्षा व्यवस्था के अंदर में, उसको अपने को हमेशा दूर करने की चिंता हम लोग करते रहते हैं. और इसी क्रम में आज मैंने जो टॉप तैयार किया है वो है कि प्रकृति से हम कैसे सीखें, क्योंकि प्रकृति से जुड़ेंगे, संसार से जुड़ेंगे और उसी में से साइंस को सीखेंगे, तो फिर साइंस को प्रकृति के लिए हम इस्तेमाल भी करेंगे, प्रकृति की भलाई के लिए इस्तेमाल करेंगे, उसकी खराबी के लिए इस्तेमाल नहीं करेंगे. तो शुरू से ही जो हम साइंस सीखते हैं वो कैसे हम सीख सकते हैं अपनी सराउंडिंग से, अपने घर से, अपने किचन से, अपने बाग बगीचों से, अपने स्पोर्ट्स ग्राउंड से, अपनी सड़कों से, वो हम कैसे सीख सकते हैं और कैसे अपने को जोड़ सकते हैं, साइंस को और संसार को हम कैसे जोड़ सकते हैं, ये थीम लेकर के हम चल रहे हैं. आज नेशनल साइंस डे है और नेशनल साइंस डे की ये का ये बड़ा संदेश इस प्रकार का होना ही चाहिए. जगह जगह कार्यक्रम हो रहे हैं. अभिषेक जी भी बता रहे थे कि शिक्षा सुपन एनजीओ के साथ भी मैं जुड़ा हुआ हूँ, जो IIT कैंपस के आसपास के गाँवों के अंदर में और जो लोग रहते हैं उनके साथ में काम कर रहे हैं. तो अपने यहाँ एक सोपान आश्रम की जगह है IIT के पास में, जहाँ शिक्षा सोपान का केंद्र है, और विशेष रूप से ये एक साइंस टूरिज्म का केंद्र इस रूप में विकसित हो रहा है. और आज जिस समय मैं यहाँ आपसे बातें कर रहा हूँ, मुझसे कुछ 20 मीटर की दूरी पर इस सोपान आश्रम के अंदर में एक विज्ञान मेला चल रहा है, जिसमें जो हमारे छात्र है, छात्र छात्राएं हैं, जो कि IIT कैंपस के आसपास 3-4 किलोमीटर के दायरे में रहते हैं, तो उन बच्चों ने एक मेला तैयार किया है और वो चल रहा है. लोग आ रहे हैं और बच्चे प्रेजेंट कर रहे हैं, और 10 दिन जो बच्चों ने उसके लिए तैयारी की है उसमें यही थीम रही है, यही थीम रही है कि हम प्रकृति से कैसे साइंस को सीख सकते हैं. तो मैं थोड़ा अपने एक प्रेजेंटेशन है उसको शेयर करता हूँ और फिर आगे हम उसके आधार के ऊपर बातें करते हैं. तो मेरे ख्याल से प्रेजेंटेशन मेरा शेयर होना चाहिए. ठीक है ना, दिख रहा
हाँ
है.
सर, हाँ सर,
तो लर्निंग साइंस थ्रू नेचर, ये हमारे आज का विषय है. और अगर हम इसमें आगे चलें, मैं लेजर ले लूँ, तो हम इसको एक एक करके थोड़े से जो मैंने किए हैं, जो जैसे जैसे मुझे प्रकृति से रोजाना कुछ कुछ मिलता है, साइंस सीखने का कुछ न कुछ मौका मिल जाता है अपने जीवन से, अपने आसपास से, अपने जो रोजाना के काम होते हैं उनमें से, उन्हीं में से कुछ को मैं लेकर के चलूंगा इसके अंदर में. भारत जो है, इंडिया, ये हम लोग बाई नेचर नेचर के बहुत क्लोज हैं. बाई नेचर हम लोग नेचर के बहुत क्लोज हैं, क्योंकि ये कोई भी एनोनेट नहीं करें प्लीज, प्लीज कोई भी एनोनेट नहीं करें. तो हमारी जो संस्कृति है, 5,000-7,000 साल पुरानी जो हमारी संस्कृति है, उस संस्कृति के अंदर में हम लोग हमेशा हम लोग हमेशा प्रकृति के प्रेमी रहे हैं और प्रकृति के पूजक रहे हैं, और साइंस जो है वो अपने प्रकृति के ही नियमों को ढंग से जानना, चाहे वो माइक्रो स्केल पर हो या मैक्रो स्केल पर हो, और इसलिए ये संबंध भारतवर्ष का तो साइंस के साथ में बहुत पुराना है और होना चाहिए, इस बहुत नेचुरल है। तो आगे देखते हैं जो साइंस लर्निंग है, लर्निंग साइंस फ्रॉम नेचर हम कहते हैं, तो उसके ये दो कंपोनेंट्स मैंने लिखे हैं। एक है कि पहला है बल्कि अप्रिशिएट द नेचर, पहली चीज है कि जो अपनी प्रकृति है उसमें जो घटनाएं होती हैं, उसके जो नियम है, वो जो चलती है, उसको हम अप्रिशिएट करते हैं क्या, उसको हम, हमारी ऐसी पारखी नजर है क्या कि हम उसको एंजॉय करते हैं, हमको बहुत अच्छा लगता है, ओ नेचर इज लाइक दिस। सो दिस अप्रिशिएशन इज द फॉरमोस्ट थिंग, एंड वंस वी अप्रिशिएट द नेचर देन वी एक्सप्लोर इन टू इट। और वो जब हम एक्सप्लोर करने जाते हैं देन वी नीड ऑपरेटर्स, देन वी नीड सोफिस्टिकेटेड टेक्निक्स, बिकॉज एक्सप्लोरेशन जितना डीप होता है, राइट, डीपर वी एक्सप्लोर वी नीड मोर सोफिस्टिकेटेड टेक्नोलॉजी एंड इंस्ट्रूमेंट एंड ऑल दैट। बट इट ऑल स्टार्ट्स फ्रॉम समथिंग विच इज हैपनिंग इन द नेचर। सो दैट इज दैट विजन, आई हैव दैट विजन दैट you look at anything in nature, in your surrounding, in your life, and then one thing is, yes, ठीक है, जैसे मुझे पेंटिंग नहीं आती है, okay? तो बहुत अच्छी सी बढ़िया से बढ़िया भी पेंटिंग मेरे सामने आप रखेंगे तो शायद मैं उसको अप्रिशिएट नहीं करूंगा, मुझे लगा हाँ ठीक है कुछ बना हुआ है। लेकिन जो पेंटर होते हैं, जो आर्टिस्ट होते हैं, वो उसको देख करके और कितनी बारीक चीजें उसके अंदर में से देखते हैं, एंजॉय करते हैं, और फिर वो उसकी उसको अगर एक्सप्लोर करते हैं, उससे और आगे बढ़ते हैं। तो उसी प्रकार की चीज साइंस के साथ में है कि अप्रिशिएट करना नेचर की चीजों को, ये सबसे पहला है, और वो अगर हमने करना शुरू किया तो फिर उसको एक्सप्लोर करना है, फिर उसके ऊपर एक्सपेरिमेंट्स करना है, फिर उसको समझना, उसको एक्सटेंड करना। और जो जैसे डायरेक्टर साहब अभी कह रहे थे कि जब हम कोई प्रोडक्ट बनाते हैं तो हम बहुत सारी जो टेक्नोलॉजी का अभ्यास करते हैं, समझते हैं, उससे और बहुत सारी चीजें बना लेते हैं। तो हमने नेचर की किसी एक चीज को अप्रिशिएट किया होगा और उसको एक्सप्लोर करने के लिए निकले होंगे, बट वंस वी स्टार्ट एक्सप्लोरिंग दैट पर्टिकुलर पीस ऑफ दैट इवेंट, देन वी कम अप विथ सेवरल न्यू थिंग्स वी अंडरस्टैंड, और उसको फिर हम लोग यूज करते हैं, उसके हम चीजें करते हैं। डॉक्टर सी वी रमन जिनके रिसर्च को सेलिब्रेट करने के लिए नेशनल साइंस डे बनाते हैं, वो भी कहते हैं 1921 में जब वो लंदन से लौट रहे थे और 15 दिन शिप पर थे, तो जो समुद्र के पानी का कलर था, दैट ब्लूइश टिंच और ब्लू वाटर, दैट एक्साइटेड है कि मैं अपने गिलास में पानी पीता हूँ वो तो कलरलेस है, लेकिन ये समुद्र का पानी जो है, वाई दिस इज ब्लू। सो दे आर एक्साइटेड एंड देन स्टार्टेड एक्सप्लोरिंग इट। तो कैसे हम नेचर से सीखते हैं, देखिए आज का नेशनल साइंस डे का प्रोग्राम भी अगर आज हो रहा है तो ये इसी से शुरू हुआ था, कभी कभी इसी से शुरू हुआ था कि किसी ने नेचर के किसी एक चीज को, जो बहुत सिंपल है, जिसके लिए कुछ नहीं है, हिंदुस्तान में जगह जगह समुद्र है और जगह जगह लोग जा सकते हैं और देखते हैं, हजारों की संख्या में लोग बीच के ऊपर टूरिज्म के लिए जाते हैं, घूमने के लिए जाते हैं, कभी देखते हैं, बहुत सिंपल सी चीज है, बट इफ ही अप्रिशिएट्स द ब्यूटी ऑफ दिस ब्लू कलर, साइंटिफिक ब्यूटी, नॉट आर्टिस्टिक ब्यूटी, तो फिर उसको वो एक्सप्लोर करते हैं। एंड देन कैलकटा में अपना जो कल्टीवेशन ऑफ साइंस, इंडियन एसोसिएशन ऑफ कल्टीवेशन साइंस, वहां पर उसके इंस्ट्रूमेंट्स बना करके और करके और तरह तरह के एक्सपेरिमेंट्स करके उसको एक्सप्लोर करते हैं, एंड देन ही कम्स अप विथ दिस सेलिब्रेटेड रामन इफेक्ट, दैट इफ वन वेवलेंथ, सिंगल कलर लाइट इज पास थ्रू अ लिक्विड देन यू गेट एडिशनल वेवलेंथ्स इन द ट्रांसमिटेड, एंड दैट एडिशनल वेवलेंथ्स, द शिफ्ट इन द वेवलेंथ्स और एडिशन और द डिफरेंस इन द वेवलेंथ्स, दैट डिपेंड्स ऑन द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ द ऑफ दैट लिक्विड और वेपर। तो आज उसकी कहीं भी आप जाते हैं, किसी भी यूनिवर्सिटी में जहाँ की अच्छी अच्छा अच्छी पढ़ाई होती है, अच्छे रिसर्च होते हैं, यू सी समवेयर रमन स्पेक्ट्रोस्कोपी लैब और लेजर रमन स्पेक्ट्रोस्कोपी लैब एंड सो ऑन सो फोर्थ, सीरीज ऑफ पेपर्स इन नेचर एंड अदर वेरियस जर्नल्स ऑल स्टार्टेड फ्रॉम दैट. उसके पहले वायलिन पे, वीणा पे, तबला पे, मृदंगम पे, ये जो म्यूजिकल इंस्ट्रूमेंट्स हैं अपने इंडिया के अंदर में, जो उन्होंने देखे थे सुने थे, उनको उसी तरीके से उसकी उसके जो साउंड क्वालिटी है और जो स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ साउंड है और जिस इंस्ट्रूमेंट से वो निकल रहा है उसके साथ में हाउ दैट रिलेशन है, उसको एक्सप्लोर करके और उसके ऊपर वो जो उनके रिसर्चेस हुए हैं उन्होंने उसको स्थापित किया है कि एज अ रिसर्चर. एंड दैट इज व्हाई ही वाज रिसीव्ड एट लंदन बाय स्टॉलवर्ट्स लाइक रदरफोर्ड एंड. तो इस तरीके से साइंस चलती है. हम लोग अपनी टेक्स्ट बुक्स के अंदर में जो पढ़ाते हैं, जो पढ़ते हैं, वो बहुत छोटा हिस्सा होता है और बड़ा फॉर्मल टाइप का होता है. तो एक्चुअल इतनी लर्निंग हमारी हो कि हम कुछ उसमें ऐड कर सके. जो साइंस का नॉलेज है, जो टेक्स्ट बुक्स होंगी, वो जो नॉलेज है उसी को प्रेजेंट कर सकती हैं. सिलेबस में हम उसी को रख सकते हैं जो ऑलरेडी है अपने पास में. और अगर हमने ये अपने अंदर ये कल्चर इनकलकेट किया नहीं है कि हम नेचर को अप्रिशिएट करते हैं और फिर उसको एक्सप्लोर करते हैं, अपनी तरफ से उसके ऊपर एक्सपेरिमेंट्स करते हैं, अपनी तरफ से उसको हम खोज खबर करते हैं, if we do not have that, then we are not adding to the knowledge. We are only getting the knowledge which is already there. And therefore, this is important. Looking at that science has to solve many, many big problems, it's important that our population, our young generation, our students, the more percentage of that is empowered to add knowledge in science and then use that in टेक्नोलॉजी. ओके, सो ये छोटा सा एक आप देखें विज्ञान सीखने का है पहला संदेश. पारखी नजर से देखें परिवेश. परिवेश इज सराउंडिंग एंड पारखी इज द वन विच कैन लुक इन टू डिटेल्स एंड सी व्हाट इट इज. फिर करें नाप जोख और माथा पच्ची. दैट इज एक्सप्लोरेशन. नाप जोख माथा पच्ची तभी खुलेंगे विज्ञान की परिस्थिति. All right, so my own experiences. This is a small video and the background is that there is a plastic table and I was having breakfast and I am very careless while taking the breakfast and so many small pieces of my sattu paratha are on this table. My breakfast is over and then I'm trying to collect them and clean the table and then you see what happens. Video is running slow. Okay. Still, you can see when I am trying to collect them at one place, bringing the finger, trying to collect them at one place, they are all flying apart. Okay, they are all flying apart. Right, the video speed is not very good, and therefore it is in steps. But see how this. These small particles are going apart. So can we talk of charging, friction and repulsion and attraction, charging by induction and all those things?
प्रातःकाल मेरे जलपान के बाद का दृश्य है क्योंकि स्वादिष्ट पराठे के अवशेष यहाँ टेबल के ऊपर दिखते हैं. और उन अवशेषों में कितनी ऊर्जा है इसको आप देखें. देखो इनका नृत्य है, इनका आनंद है, बहुत ही रोचक, बहुत ही प्रेरणादायी और बहुत ही सुंदर है.
ऑलराइट, सो लेट मी गो अहेड. So the message is that this science is everywhere, all time. किसी भी आप टाइम पे देखो और कहीं पर भी देखो तो चल रहा है. जो जो होल एवरी इवेंट इन द नेचर इज अ साइंटिफिक एक्सपेरिमेंट. ऑलराइट, सो इफ यू कैन एक्सप्लोर दैट, इफ यू कैन अप्रिशिएट द ब्यूटी ऑफ दैट, एंड फ्रॉम देयर वी कनेक्ट व्हाट वी रीड इन द टेक्स्ट बुक्स, एंड देन वी लर्न एंड वी गेट इमोशनल अटैचमेंट विथ साइंस विथ नेचर, तो फिर हम बहुत एम्पावर्ड हो सकते हैं आगे के लिए. आप सोचो ये फॉलिंग एप्पल्स है, ये भी एक नेचुरल इवेंट है ना. इट्स वेरी सिंपल थिंग, थिंग्स फॉल, एनीथिंग दैट इफ यू लीव एनीथिंग इट फॉल्स ऑन द ग्राउंड. और एप्पल्स व्हेन दे आर राइप, मैंगोज व्हेन दे आर राइप, और नहीं भी राइप होते हैं तो हम पत्थर वत्थर मार करके उनको अपने पेड़ से अलग कर देते हैं, दे फाइनली दे फॉल ऑन द ग्राउंड. कितनी मजे की बात है ये. अगर ये नहीं हुआ होता, अगर ये ऊपर उड़े होते तो फिर क्या होता, फिर हम खाते कैसे सेव और रखते कैसे सेव अपनी डलिया के अंदर में या अपने बास्केट के अंदर. लुक एट दिस नेचुरल इवेंट. वी ऑल नो दैट इन इन प्लेसेस लाइक हिली एरियाज, श्रीनगर फॉर एग्जांपल, डल लेक, वो टेम्परेचर बिकम्स वेरी वेरी कोल्ड इन विंटर्स, नेगेटिव. And we say that कि वो freeze हो गया, that lake freeze हो गया, that dull lake has frozen. क्या frozen? क्या क्या freeze हो गया? Only a top layer, only maybe 1 or 2 centimeters of water. और उसके नीचे तो पानी रहता है और अपनी मछलियाँ वगैरह जो है पानी के वो सब उसके अंदर में घूमते रहते. कितने मजे की बात है, कितने मजे की बात है. और अगर इसको हम ये कोशिश करें जानने की, एक्सप्लोर करने की, इसको और डीपर समझने की, ऐसे क्यों हो रहा है, देन वी कम अक्रॉस येट अनदर अमेजिंग थिंग दैट नॉर्मली व्हेन वी हीट समथिंग इट एक्सपैंड्स, राइट. बट वाटर इज वेरी वेरी स्पेशल, वाटर इज वेरी वेरी स्पेशल. फ्रॉम 0 degrees Celsius इफ यू हीट वाटर इट डजंट एक्सपैंड, इट कॉन्ट्रैक्ट्स. And that contraction goes on till 4 degrees Celsius, where the density is maximum. It has contracted maximum, and after that, once again, it start expanding. Now, if you can enjoy that, oh, water is so special. Water is so special. It has a very different kind of expansion characteristic, and you try to explore that. Then you go into the microscopic world. क्या होता है, क्या होता है, गर्म करने से क्या होता है, ठंडा करने से क्या होता है पानी के अंदर में. एंड देन व्हेन यू एक्सप्लोर दैट, देन यू कम आउट विथ द रियल नॉलेज. ऐसे ही देखें, जो पाइप में हमारे प्लास्टिक के पाइप में से पानी हम लोग ले जाते हैं, बीच में क्रैक हो जाता है तो वहां से पानी निकलने लगता है जहां से हम नहीं चाहते हैं. So this is a photograph, and you can see from here that you have this plastic pipe. This is a plastic pipe in my field. ये आप देख रहे हैं कहाँ का क्या क्या चीज़ें यहाँ पर लगे हुए हैं पौधे, और यहाँ से पाइप में एक पंक्चर है, एक छेद है. So although the water is flowing in this pipe and going is at its destination, but some water is coming out from here. And it's going in a nice curve. यहाँ से ऐसा निकल करके the water is going. It looks like कि जो हम पढ़ते हैं किताब में कि projectile को किसी angle पे project करो तो parabola के path में जाता है, तो वो दिखता है यहाँ पे कि हाँ कुछ कुछ तो हो रहा है. But if you look at this photograph and see कैसा दिख रहा है आपको, पानी कैसे दिख रहा है, right? पानी कैसे दिख रहे हैं यहाँ पे, देखो पानी की स्ट्रीम नहीं दिख रही है इन सब जगहों पे. इन सब जगहों पे हमें बहुत तेज पानी आ रहा है, बहुत तेज पानी आ रहा है, इतनी ऊंचाई तक गया है ये. बट देन दीज आर, लगता है कि आइस के क्रिस्टल्स है, ओले हैं, लगता है कि हेलस्टॉर्म है. अभी सीधा सीधा पानी चल रहा है और लीक में से निकल रहा है और मैंने फोटो खींच लिया है. बट देन अब इसके अंदर अगर जाए आप तो देखो कितनी चीजें सीखने को मिलती हैं. ये जब चलता है पानी तो वो पानी लिक्विड की तरह से एक कंटिन्यूटी में नहीं है. फर्स्ट थिंग इज दैट पानी के ये लंप्स है, लिक्विड है, लिक्विड है लेकिन कनेक्टेड नहीं है. लिक्विड में ही लग रहा है जैसे कि सॉलिड की तरह से है. फिर उनके साइज का डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन देख सकते हैं, कुछ बहुत छोटे छोटे हैं, कुछ बहुत छोटे छोटे हैं, कुछ बहुत बड़े बड़े भी हैं. उनका साइज का डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन देख सकते हैं, ऐसे कैसे हो रहा है. और अगर उससे भी आप आगे बढ़े तो फिर आप एंगल एंगल को भी देख सकते हो कि यहाँ जिस एंगल से ये निकल रहा है उसी एंगल से ये गिर नहीं रहा है. तो क्या हो रहा है रास्ते के अंदर में. सो मेनी थिंग्स टू लर्न, सो मेनी थिंग्स टू लर्न. वट एवर बेसिक इक्वेशन वी हैव लर्न, एक्स इज इक्वल टू यूटी प्लस हाफ जी टी स्क्वायर वगैरह वगैरह, उनका आप अब इस्तेमाल कीजिए. जो नेचुरल फेनोमेना है, जो प्रकृति आपको सवाल दे रही है, उसको हल करिए. टेक्स्ट बुक में तो सवाल बड़े अच्छे अच्छे होते हैं कि हमने वी हैव प्रोजेक्टेड ए बॉल एट एंगल ऑफ 60 डिग्रीज फ्रॉम वर्टिकल विद अ स्पीड ऑफ 10 मीटर पर सेकेंड एंड वेयर इट विल फॉल एंड दिस एंड दैट फिनिश. बट द नेचर इज पोजिंग, इज गिविंग यू न्यू प्रॉब्लम्स टू सॉल्व यूजिंग द सेम इक्वेशंस. एंड व्हेन यू डू दिस यू कम अक्रॉस सो मेनी थिंग्स एंड यू लर्न सो मेनी थिंग्स. ऑलराइट, वेयर डज द वाटर गो. कपड़े हम जब धो के सुखाते तो सूख जाते हैं, सभी लोग देखते हैं, सभी लोग सुखाते हैं, सभी लोग पहनते हैं फिर कपड़े. बट अगर हमारी पारखी नजर है, इफ वी कैन एंजॉय द ब्यूटी ऑफ दिस नेचर, देन पॉसिबली वी शुड बी अमेज्ड कि ये कैसे कपड़े सूख जाते हैं, पानी कहाँ चला जाता है, इवापरेट हो जाता है. अब इवापरेशन के अंदर घुसे, एक्सप्लोर करें उसको. व्हाट इज इवापरेशन, क्यों होता है इवापरेशन. देन वी कम अक्रॉस करे, अच्छा इट्स बिकॉज ऑफ रैंडम मॉलिकुलर स्पीड मैक्सवेलियन वेलोसिटी डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन. एट वन टेम्परेचर यू हैव वन मीन स्पीड, राइट, और मीन स्क्वायर टेम्परेचर. एक टेम्परेचर पर अगर आप रहेंगे तो जो स्पीड्स हैं आप कनेक्ट कर सकते हैं, वॉट एवर रूट थ्री कैपिटल आर कैपिटल टी बाई कैपिटल एम वगैरह जो कुछ हम लोग पढ़ते हैं किताबों के अंदर. वन टेम्परेचर वन स्पीड. बट एक एक मॉलिक्यूल का अगर अलग अलग देखें तो उनकी स्पीड बहुत अलग अलग है. वैसे तो रैंडम है लेकिन वो रैंडमनेस में भी बहुत कुछ ऑर्डर है. दैट इज व्हाई वी हैव ए फंक्शन, वी हैव डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन ऑफ वेलोसिटीज. बिकॉज ऑफ दैट सम ऑफ द मॉलिक्यूल्स हैव एनफ एनर्जी टू गो आउट ऑफ दिस वाटर मास और उसको हम इवापोरेशन कहते हैं. तो कितनी प्यारी चीज है कपड़े सूखना, कितनी प्यारी चीज है. और उसकी वहीं से अंदर घुसे हम तो मैक्सवेल डिस्ट्रीब्यूशंस और वगैरह वगैरह बहुत सारे चीजों का हम वास्तव में कनेक्ट कर सकते हैं. जो हम पढ़ते हैं उसको हम अपने लाइफ से, अपने साइंस से, अपने इससे हम कनेक्ट कर सकते हैं. आवर स्पोर्ट्स आर ऑल वेरी वेरी ब्यूटिफुल. ओके, आई कैन कीप ऑन telling you thousands of things where the nature is all the time posing problems for you to look at it, enjoy, explore, understand, empower yourself. And as you get empowered, face more problems, take up more challenges, solve them, and the process goes on. Oscillations is another beautiful phenomenon. Anything stable, if it is disturbed little bit, it oscillates. और वो oscillation आपको हर जगह दिखता है प्रकृति के अंदर, right? This is in my house, in my almira. Okay, the video is going in steps. Otherwise, it's a beautiful oscillation, right? And this oscillation is related to how the earth is attracting the key, that universe square, 1/r² law, and all those things. Okay. Now here is an experiment. We have many of you know polarizers. We have some kind of specially made sheets which act as polarizer. When light passes through such sheets, what you have is a particular component of light having electric field in a direction is allowed to go through and other is blocked. So using that polarizer, let's see what kind of experiments I can show you. See, in this what you are seeing is a glass plate. It's a glass plate, and it is kept in bright sun, and the sunlight is falling on the glass plate and is reflecting from there, the top surface, the bottom surface, and we are barely able to, perhaps barely able to guess what is inside, what is below this glass plate, right? The video will show you, I will be bringing this plastic sheet, which is a polarizer, between this glass plate and my camera, and my eyes also, in fact, but camera. And then this plastic sheet will be rotated in its own plane, and then you see what happens. This is that sheet which I am bringing. This is the sheet that I am bringing, and almost no change. It is just like that. But now I'm rotating. Now I'm rotating. And as I rotate the sheet, see, I'm rotating. And then see what is happening. Then see what is happening. This beautiful flower is now clearly visible. The sunlight, the bright sunlight, is still falling on that glass plate. This plastic sheet is not between the sun and the glass plate. It is between the glass plate and my eyes, or the camera's eyes. The light is still falling on this glass plate. It is still reflecting, but it is not reaching my eyes because of this plastic sheet, and in a particular orientation. How beautiful. How beautiful. This is another beautiful experiments with these polarizer sheets. We have two of them. We have two of them, and they are packed in a polythene bag. In fact, when I purchased it, it came in this particular polythene bag. And this polythene bag is my main instrument in this experiment. The polarizer sheets is, of course, they are there, but see the role of this polythene bag. So these are the two sheets. These are the two sheets. This orientation. This is one experiment, but this is not the focus right now. What I'm going to do, one sheet going in the bag and one is outside. Okay. And you see some greenish color has appeared. There was no such greenish color. And at what place? Where you have the glue to close that plastic bag, polythene bag. Now I'm rotating the polythene bag and see what is happening. See the kind of color appearing. Look at it. Look at it. Look at the colors which are appearing. Our polythene sheets are such a valuable instrument to learn science. Now explore into it and you learn so many things. Now next, we are putting the two polarizer sheets in different orientation and repeating the same thing. One inside the bag, one outside the bag. Now see the strip color, golden. That was greenish, this is golden. And now I'm rotating. That was greenish, bluish. And look at this. Look at this. Look at the color of this polythene. Totally different color. Our polythenes are not. See the strip color. See the strip color. Very different. Anything around us is a good science instrument. And you can learn so many things so enjoyably. So enjoyably. All right, in another orientation. Okay, now one sheet is outside the bag, one sheet is inside the bag. The whole bag is between the two polarizers, and now we are rotating. And see the color, violet, bright violet, beautiful color. And the color depends on the intense or the sharpness of color depends on the orientation, no color here, but here, yes, and then it becomes deeper and deeper and deeper. All right. So our materials, anything that is there, you can enjoy the beauty, you can appreciate the beauty. In this pandemic, we conducted Indian Association of Physics Teachers. We have a chapter called Anveshika, National Anveshika Network of India. We call it NANI. So it conducts an experimental skill test every year. For several years, we had been doing this. But this particular year, 2020, we were not able to call students in our 26 laboratories, which are there across the nation. And therefore, to conduct experimental skill test was very, very challenging. But then we did it. We did it. And how we did it? Our team designed some experiments, 5 experiments, in fact, which could be done with the household materials only. So our house, our home, our kitchen, our drawing room, our almirah, the kind of stuff that we have, they are all our physics instrument, and the entire house, entire home is physics laboratory. So on that concept, we designed 5 experiments, asked the students to perform these experiments, and then share the result. And from there, the skill test was conducted. Some 48,000 students enrolled for it. And after initial screening, we screened some 1,200 students, 1,200 students, and they were given this task of performing the experiment. And they were not just demonstration experiments like the ones that I have shown you in this talk. They were full-fledged experiments, data collection, accuracy, error analysis, and then plotting, if the graphs are involved, plotting graphs, interpretation of graphs, coming out with the meaningful quantity from that experiment. So any characteristic of a good school college experiment was there on top of it. The students had to assemble their own setup and decide for the material that they will be using. They were strictly told nothing to purchase, even from the grocery shop, nothing to purchase. 2 measuring instruments are always in the house. If there are students in the house, then we assume that some 6 inches plastic scale will be there in the geometry box, so you can measure the length from there. And if you are doing something online, your phone will have stopwatch, so you can measure time. So with these 2 instruments, we design all that. And one of the experiment was rolling of balan. Right, the balan with which we spread chapatis, chakla balan. So aap dekho, wo chakla balan hai, aur us balan ko ek plane ke upar roll karaya ja raha hai, and the person is having a smartphone in the left hand and will be measuring time this balan will take to go from one point on this inclined plane to the other point, and that time will be measured. Now, it's very simple, right? It looks very simple, but then the task was challenging. The task was challenging because we wanted, not wanted, we were the optimum inclination. If the inclination is 10 degrees, then it will go so fast that you will have a lot of errors in measurement. And therefore, the inclination has to be very small. And having that small inclination, in fact, the optimum was something like 4 degrees, so 2 degrees inclination, 4 degrees inclination, 6 degrees inclination, 8 degrees inclinations, collected data for these different inclinations, measured the angle accurately. Now, to measure the angle of 2 degrees, first make an angle of 2 degrees and then measure it. All these kinds of very, very, very nice, very challenging and very refreshing kind of activities that was added. In school college laboratories, there are fixed materials, instruments that are given to you. and there are fixed rules in which they have to be assembled. But here, each house had, each student has his own story to tell. And you will be surprised. In the finals, then we had, this was semi-final, then we had finals and all that. In finals, in one of the experiments, a student wrote 106 pages long report on that one single experiment that was done at home. Okay, so very, very enjoyable and enriching experience. Right. Now our doors, wonderful, wonderful instruments of learning rotational dynamics. Axis of rotation and the V's omega cross R, and then rotate by a particular angle in a particular time. So many things one can do with this and so on. Okay. And include that in the talk.
And what the experiment is, that will be revealed only after the experiment is completed. So I am holding this paper and cutting a hole in this, and the size, the shape of the hole is very different. It's not circular. If I open it, you can see what is the kind of this shape here. You see the shape? Oh, yeah. Now another one. For the another one, let me fold it in perpendicular direction. In perpendicular direction, and then I cut a similar hole like this. This is another hole. This is another hole. And then let me cut yet another hole at some angle. So I will fold it at some angle. Let us say at this angle. And then I will again cut a hole, and that hole is like this. It is yet another hole. So varieties of holes I have. All right. And as you can see, the sunlight is falling on this paper. This is a shadow of my hand. So the sunlight is coming and falling on this paper. And then on the other side, we have a wall. And you can also see that the sunlight is. So the experiment is, I will allow this sunlight to fall on this paper in which I have cut the holes, and then a shadow will be formed on the wall, and in the shadow you will have some lighted areas because light will be passing through these holes. So let us see what kind of patches are seen. Let me make this hole slightly bigger. I've just made this hole slightly big. Now I have three holes. These are the three holes of three different shapes. This is close to a parallelogram. This is an oblique type of shape, or a convex lens type of shape. And this is maybe convex lens with a much larger focal length. So now I'll be allowing this sunlight to go through this and fall on the wall. And the camera will focus on the wall. Gradually, the camera will go to the wall to show you the shadow and the light in there. So here it is. Here is the camera from this paper to the place where the shadow is falling. And in the shadow, you can see three bright, circular, bright areas. The light which is passing through these three holes of very different shapes and sizes, all are making circular is on the wall. Camera back to the same spot again. Camera back to the same spot again.
Okay. What a beautiful experiment. What a beautiful and what a simple experiment. The holes you have seen, what kind of holes I had cut. But the on the other side, light which is passing through this long hole is creating a bright circular path there. So if you can enjoy that, if you can see the beauty in it, the way nature works, and then explore into that, and then you understand that, okay, what it is. Now, this is another activity that we very regularly do. In this activity itself, if you can measure the diameter of that bright disc that you saw on the wall, if this diameter you can measure, and if this distance you can measure, which is very simple, use a plastic scale to measure this diameter and some tape to measure this length, and then using that, what you can get is, using similar triangles, you can get the diameter of the sun or the sun's disk that we see. So suraj ka vyas naap liya apne kuch 1 minute ka experiment aur 5 minute ka mathematics कर लिया तो आपको सूरज का व्यास भी मिल गया. ओके, लेट मी टॉक लिटिल बिट ऑन मैथमेटिक्स, 2-3 स्लाइड्स एंड देन आई विल क्लोज. मैथमेटिक्स देयर आल्सो यू कैन एंजॉय लॉट ऑफ इट नंबर्स इन आवर स्टैंडर्ड 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9 10 11 12 वी लर्न नंबर्स ग्रेजुअली. फर्स्ट वी लर्न होल नंबर्स, and then we learn rationals, and then irrationals, and finally complex numbers, and so on and so on. Now on the number line, if I have these two points and ask how many numbers are there, right, the only answer is it's either one or infinity. If these two are coincident, I have put two marks one over the other, okay, then there is only one number there. But the moment they are two, no matter how close they are, the moment they are two different marks, how many numbers are in between, that number is infinity. Is it not very, very special? Now in this drawing, I have made a line AB and a longer line CD, and A to C I have joined. And then from any point P on AB, I can draw a parallel line, parallel to AC, and that will meet the second line at Q. So for each point in AB, I have a corresponding point on this CE, and for each point of CE, I have a corresponding point on AB. Point by point, I can match. This point corresponds to this, this point corresponds to this, this point corresponds to this. That means the number of points in AB is same as number of points in CE, and therefore CD will have many more points. But the same AB here and the same CD here, I am doing this another drawing. I join this BD, and I join this CA, and they are meeting somewhere here. And then take any point P in AB and join this to P, and that will intersect CD in Q. So for every point P, I have a Q. You take a point here and then join this point to this point, and then produce, and you get a point here. So for every point in AB, I have a point in CD. And for every point in CD, give me any point on CD, I can always join this to this top point, and that will intersect AB at one point. So for every point in CD, I have one and one point in AB. For every point in AB, I have one and only one point in CD. Number of points in AB is same as number of points in CD. Okay, enjoyed? Sum of exterior angles is 360 degrees, irrespective of how many sides are there in the polygon, is triangle or quadrilateral or a hexagon, whatever. द सम ऑफ एक्सटीरियर एंगल्स इज ऑलवेज 360 डिग्रीज जनरली पीपल डू नॉट टॉक अबाउट दैट दे टॉक ऑफ इंटीरियर एंगल्स ट्राइंगल इट इज 180 डिग्रीज द सम ऑफ थ्री एंगल्स इज 180 क्वाड्रिलेटरल 360 एंड देन दे आस्क ओके इफ इट इज हेक्सागन हाउ मच विल बी द टोटल इफ इट इज ऑक्टोगन हाउ मच विल बी द टोटल बट द मोर इंटरेस्टिंग थिंग इज independent of the number of sides, the sum of the exterior angles is always 360 degrees. Enjoy the beauty. Enjoy the beauty. Okay, root 2. You cannot write the value of root 2 exactly with your pen. Exact value of root 2. No matter how many decimal places you write, you cannot write exact value. Therefore, you have to leave it in that symbol square root of 2. But you can do it with a scale and a compass. You can draw a line of exact length root 2. Okay, and it's very simple. Just do this. If you can draw a line of 1 centimeter exactly, you can draw a line of root 2 centimeter exactly. Root 2 in itself, you cannot write that exactly. But then you can draw a line of root 2 centimeter. What a beautiful thing all it is. This equation, I'm really fascinated about it. E to the power I is 1. Okay, now look at the things which are there. E, I and pi. all are very, very special number, not very common, not very common. What is E? Another irrational number, some 2.71 something. And I only can tell you the series, never ending series. So that is E, irrational number, will not end. You can write 25 decimals, 250 decimals, billion, trillion decimals, it will never end. I is even more special, imaginary, square root of minus 1, what kind of number it is. And pi is further another irrational number, 3.14159926, blah, 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 blah. But when you have e to the power I pi, e to the power I pi, what do you get? You get 1. Wonderful. Wonderful. So from whatever you have in your surrounding, mathematics is also everywhere in your surrounding. All right. So whatever you have in your surrounding, you can learn science from there, you can learn mathematics from there, and then explore it further. One thing is that you just see and say, oh, it is so fine. That is also very good. But after that, if you explore, if you go deeper into it, use the facilities of inter-university accelerator center and other such facilities which are there in the nation, and then empower yourself. Contribute towards adding more and more knowledge which we have in our human mind. Use that in making apparatus, use that in getting solutions of the problems that we face. So thank you very much. I'll stop here. Abhishek, you can stop my presentation.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you for a very fundamental lecture and a very nice lecture. Since you are not physically present with us, we cannot express our appreciation. But the least we can do is that I request all the participants to give sir a big round of virtual applause at least. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Now we can take a few questions. Participants can type their questions in the chat box. There are few questions I have already seen while the lecture was going on, so I can read a few of them. So you can also see it in your chat box. So if you want to answer any particular question directly, you can only.
You can tell me the question.
Okay. This is somewhat not related to this. There is a question from Himanshu Yadav. Sir, what if there are muons present in the electrons inside atom? Is it possible for a way to do that? And if it is, how it would affect everything the way we see now.
I don't think I'll be able to answer in short time, in a minute or so.
Yeah. There is another question by Mansi Rajput. Sir, when we put water in sunlight and it starts to evaporate and we touch the water, then why our hands do not get burnt?
Okay. See, in one of my slides, I talked about why clothes dry up. Where does the water go? Evaporation. Okay, so that same context you are referring. And the next slide I show that why evaporation takes place. Evaporation takes place because at any given temperature, be it 30 degrees Celsius or 25 degrees Celsius or 20 degrees Celsius or 40 degrees Celsius, any given temperature, the molecules are moving with different speeds. It's not one temperature and one speed. Different molecules are moving with different speeds, and there is a rule. How many molecules will move with this velocity? How many molecules will move with that velocity? There's a rule which we call Maxwell's distribution law. So even if the temperature is 30 degrees, some of the molecules are having large speeds which normally should correspond to 100 degrees Celsius. Okay, so those molecules which are having that much of energy, that much of speed, they are able to come to go out of the water mass and get evaporated and get mixed with the atmosphere. Now, if the temperature is higher, say you start with 30 degrees Celsius water and then you go for 50 degrees Celsius water, then the average speed has gone up. And if average speed have gone up, then the number of molecules with those high velocities, that has also gone up. And therefore, the evaporation is faster. But if you touch that water, if you started with 30 degrees Celsius water, it's still 30 degree water. Okay, the large number of molecules of water that are hitting your fingers, which can transfer their energy to your fingers and give the sensation of warmness. There's a large number, and therefore those small number of high speed molecules will not matter much. It's the average which will matter. That average still corresponds to 30 degrees Celsius, and therefore your hand is not burnt. Okay, Mansi?
There is one question from Mahesh Sharma. Sir, how can I measure inertial and gravitational masses experimentally to know if Einstein was right or not?
Okay, I think you work on it, okay, and then come out with some proposal, and then we will see that how it can be done, and we will also work with you.
There is one question from Devesh Sharma. Actually, it is more of a comment that regarding your Route 2 example. He says that measurement of 1 centimeter is also subject to errors.
Correct.
And hence, we may not get the exact value of
Correct.
Route 2.
I agree with that. But
and I think
but,
I also agree with
that. I agree with that. But let me respond to that. Suppose. I am able to design an experiment. I have a compass, I have a scale, all right? And suppose that the scale is graduated in such a fashion that the thickness of those lines are extremely, extremely small, negligibly small. Suppose this compass has a point which is really very, 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 very sharp point. Okay, so I can reduce the error in 1, right? And depending on how sophisticated instrument I can make, this error can be minimized, right? So in principle, I can make the error as small as I wish, if not zero. But that is not the case of Route 2. even if I have an exact measurement of 1 centimeter, at least I have the procedure. I have a scale. I have 2 points on that. One is marked 0, one is marked 1. And the procedure is to put my compass, one end should coincide with the first mark, and the second point should coincide with the second mark. And the length of that separation between those 2 points on the compass will be 1 centimeter. At least I can give you the procedure. Now it's up to you, up to your technology, up to your instrument designing, that how close you can go to it. But in principle, you can measure. I can give a recipe, I can give a procedure by which 1 centimeter can be exactly measured, but I cannot give you the procedure with that same scale, very, very sophisticated, very, very accurate scale and very, very accurate compass. Still, I cannot tell you that here are these 2 points. You coincide 1 point here, you coincide another point here, and you will get exact root 2. I cannot do that. So that's the thing. That's the thing. You cannot do it in one go, but make that 1 centimeter one side and perpendicular side another 1 centimeter, and then join. In principle, I have gotten 2 points, the separation of which is root 2 centimeter. Okay. That's the beauty.
So there is another question by Arith Road. In the polarizer experiment, we saw the plastic sheet to be violet. Why it was violet and not red?
and why not yellow? So that's it. This experiment has sparked some interest in you. Now you explore it. Now you go deeper into it. Go for the theory. Go for the explanation. And then you will learn so many things. You will learn so many things, and I can help you. I can help you. The topic you should learn is birefringence. All right. Okay. The topic you should learn is birefringence, but you learn it. I will not tell you what birefringence is and how it works and how this polythene shows different colors, which color it should show at what orientation. That you have to find out. You have to learn the requisite physics of it and requisite mathematics of it. That homework you have to do. Okay, I'm helping you to give a small first step, that birefringence, this is the name of the concept which is key to it. All right, so you learn it and then get the solution.
There is a question from Aman Kumar. Sir, why zero as a function of x is equal to 0, but 0 plus x, 0 into x, sorry, 0 multiplied by x is 0, but 0 plus x is equal to x, and yet multiplication is one type of addition.
Right, so here you have to add 0 times, okay? You have to add x 0 times, so you don't have to add even one time. Beautiful question. Beautiful questions.
One question.
A fraction A by B. Yeah. Multiply the numerator by the same number and multiply the denominator by the same number, and you do not change the number. Okay? But add same number to the numerator, say add the same number to the denominator, and you change the number. So multiplication are having amazing differences, right? In a fraction, you are allowed to multiply numerator and denominator by the same number, but you are not allowed to add same number in numerator and denominator. Amazing. So these type of things are very much there. And once you go into it, understand, then the normal concept of how many times I have added, that is the multiplication, you will go much, much beyond that and understand the basic differences in these operations. And once you can get that, perhaps that you can use in many different contexts, the different kinds of operations, having, you know, what kind of operations one can do with this, what cannot do with this, and so on and so forth. So explore.
Sir, there is one question from Dhruvi Agarwal. How can we understand quantum mechanics from the environment?
See how the quantum mechanics has come up. How that whatever Heisenberg or Niels Bohr or Einstein or Dirac or Schrodinger, Born, how could they come out with this theory called quantum mechanics? Was there a theoretical discussions among them, and they were all, they made a film, they wrote a script, a film script? No. It came from the environment only. It came from the nature only. Bang. So, or this hydrogen spectrum, right? The hydrogen gas is there, then people can heat it, people can send electrical spark in it, and then it gives very beautiful light. And when you take that light through a prism, it shows one color very sharp and another color very sharp, and in between nothing. So this is a series of experiments done by Angstrom. That same Angstrom, not Neil Angstrom who went to moon. Angstrom for this 10^-10 meter is called one Angstrom. Okay, so this that Angstrom, he did these experiments in the laboratory. All right, and then he saw all these lines. Mercury vapor lamp, very common, not very uncommon. Tube lights also have that mercury vapor. But then some fluorescence paste is there on the tube. If that paste is not there, this mercury vapor will give you light. And if you just put a prism, you will see sharp, very sharp lines, and in between nothing. This is how the nature is telling you, look at this, explore it, and you will get quantum mechanics. That is how quantum mechanics came up. Okay, Planck. Looking at radiation, looking at some hot object and the radiation coming from that, and what wavelengths are there in that. So these are actual physical phenomena nature is showing. All right, and when they explored into it, they came out with this quantum mechanics. So first is appreciate, first is observe, then appreciate, and then get so much interested into it. That is where the appreciation is important. Get so much interested into it that you explore it to the fullest, and then you come out with newer things.
Okay. There is another question from Simran Kalra. Can we perform the Young's double slit experiment at home?
Yes, very much. You can do it. You can do it. In fact, we have done it several times. What we do is, we take two strands of our own hair. Now I don't have much left on my head, but there are so many other students. I ask them to donate two hairs. Okay, so you take a cardboard, make a rectangular slit in that, not slit, rectangular opening, and these two strands are to be fixed parallel to each other and taped, and with as much small separation as you can, and then put a green laser on it and see the pattern on the other side, and you can see the interference, Young's double slit experiment, that interference pattern.
Sir, there are questions coming continuously, so we have to stop at some point, but we can take one more question maybe.
One more.
From Tanu Rana. So not everywhere the color of the ocean is blue, it is also green.
Right. So everywhere, all seas may not have same kind of minerals. Same, the water may not be identical. Very simple. What is water? Oh, see, 95% is identical or 97% is identical, but then different seeds will have different composition, different kind of molecular structures there, and therefore this molecular scattering can give you different colors. Right.
So I think, sir, we should stop here because we have to end this session now.
Yeah, yeah. Move
on to the next part.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I enjoyed this whole interaction to the fullest. So thank you very much for inviting me. So, thank you, Director Sahab. Avinashji, thank you.
So this brings us to the end of the first part of our program. And now it is my pleasant duty and privilege also to propose the vote of thanks on this occasion. First of all, I'd like to wish you a very good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon to our respected director, Professor Avinash Chandra Pandey, all the teachers and students who have joined us online today, and all the IUAC colleagues, all my IUAC colleagues who are attending the program. Good afternoon to all. On behalf of the director of IUAC and the organizing committee, I take this opportunity to express my heartfelt thanks to our speaker, Professor H.C. Verma, who has spared time from his busy schedule to grace the occasion. Sir, I am very, very much aware that you have two other programs to attend to today as well as tomorrow. And in spite of that, you have given us the time for our program. And we are extremely grateful to you for that gesture. I also thank you for delivering such a fundamental and wonderful lecture, such a fundamental lecture. It was fascinating to know in how many unthinkable ways nature can be our teacher. And how the common things which we see around lead to such big related to such big principles in physics, which we study in our textbooks. I am sure it must have been motivational not only for the young minds of the students, but also for the teachers who are attending the program. I thank you again for your stimulating presence. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
I would like to express my deepest gratitude to our respected director, Professor Avinash Chandra Pandey. Thank you, sir. Who has been the driving force behind us in organizing the program. Not only this program, he has been the driving force for all the programs that we organize. And it was only him who suggested your name to invite you for the keynote address. Sir, we are deeply indebted to you for all the guidance and the invaluable inputs that you have provided that have helped in shaping the program. And we thank you from the bottom of our hearts. Thank you, sir. Teamwork is essential to make any event a success. And the same is true for this program also. I express my sincere thanks to all the members of the organizing committee for their valuable suggestions time and again, and the efforts that they have put in communicating with the colleges across the country to invite the students and faculty for the program. I thank you to all. My special thanks are due to the members of the computer group at IUAC, without whose help the organization of this program would not have been possible. In the last part of the program, which will begin shortly, we have an interactive virtual tour of the laboratory, where the participants can interact online with the experts who are explaining the various facilities. I would like to thank all my IUAC colleagues who will be available online for the interaction. Thank you. And last but not the least, I thank all the participants who have enthusiastically attended the program, with a special mention to all the faculty members, all the teachers who have motivated the young students to register for the event. I thank you to all. And now I now request all of you to please stand up for the national anthem. After this anthem, I request all the students to please stay logged in. We will start the virtual tour of the facility. Thank you.
अधिनायक जय हिंद भारत भाग्य विधाता पंजाब सिंध गुजरात मराठा द्राविड उत्कल बंगा विंध्य हिमाचल यमुना गंगा उच्चल जगधि तरंगा तव शुभ नामे जागे, तव शुभ आशीष मागे, गाहे तव जय गाथा, जन गण मंगल गायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता, जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे।
So we now move on to the last part of our program. We have an interactive virtual tour of the laboratory, and the persons who are explaining the facilities in the video will be available online for answering any query from the participants. I request all participants to kindly use the chat box to communicate your question. Thank you and enjoy the virtual tour.
Good morning, friends. Welcome to IUAC and the fascinating world of accelerators. Here we will be showing you various accelerator facility and associated experimental facility when you go ahead in the tour. Let me begin with the oldest accelerator that we have at IUAC. This is 15 million volt accelerator, where at the cylindrical shell out here inside the accelerator, we can generate 15 million volts by Van de Graaff principle. And this high voltage is used to accelerate the ions into million electron volts. This is a vertical chamber, which has a room on the top, a room on the roof, where we have a special instrument called ion source, where we produce negative ions by attaching an extra electron to atom. This negative ion moves forward and they are bent by the magnet. This magnet not only bends the ion beam, but also ensures to select a particular ion of interest. For example, if I want to do experiment with say 28 silicon, the magnet ensures that only mass 28 goes through it and all other masses are rejected. The positive high voltage attracts the negative ion. So when the negative ion moves from here to here, it gets accelerated. When ions reach here, the energy is in million electron volts. Here, we play a trick. What we do is, these ions are made to pass through a thin foil of carbon. And when they are passing through this thin foil of carbon, it loses many electrons and become positively charged. Now, once again, the ions are accelerated. But now, due to repulsion, positive potential, positive charge ions are repelled. Here, the energy gain is more. Why the energy gain is more? Because the charge is more. Remember, E is equal to Q into V. Higher the charge, higher the acceleration. The ion beam is accelerated. They are once again deflected using a magnet. This magnet ensures that the energy of all the ions remains same. A third magnet puts the beam into one of the six experimental facility which are set up. So the experimental setup, the facility in one of the setup, and the beam is going into it, and the experiment is conducted. So all the part of the ion beam is basically controlled from a control system out here. The control system, we are taking care of beam right from ion source to the experimental facility. We are not only producing the beam and putting it to the experimental facility, but also monitoring various parameters. There are around 400 parameters to be monitored at one go. The parameters like vacuum inside the chamber, the beam current, voltage stability, and the radiation levels, all are monitored using the control system out here. The accelerator is interlocked for all kind of hazard, like radiation hazard and the high pressure hazard. This ensures accident-free operation of accelerator and makes the operation trouble-free. Thank you.
So what we see here is the superconducting linear accelerator. Now, this is a different kind of accelerator from the Pellatron in the sense that a superconducting linear accelerator uses AC voltages to accelerate the charged particle beams, as against the Pellatron, where a large DC voltage is used to accelerate the beams. This superconducting LINAC is basically a booster, energy booster to the Pellatron accelerator, and it increases the energy of the charged particle beams that are coming from the Pellatron. When this accelerator is operating at its maximum capacity, it doubles the energy of the beams that are available from the Pellatron. So this accelerator basically consists of 5 modules. What we see here are the 3 accelerating modules where actually the acceleration is taking place or the increase in the energy is taking place. Besides these 3 modules, there is a super buncher module which is used for bunching, and there is a rebuncher module also which is used, which has the same function as the super buncher, but which is used for bunching at the target location, at the experimental location. These modules, all the entire LINAC, at the heart of the LINAC is basically these structures. For the sake of clarity, we have kept one of them out. So all these modules are actually having these devices inside, which are actually accelerating the beam, and they are known as the quarter wave resonators. So this is the quarter wave resonator from the outside. And this, from the outside, it is completely surrounded by stainless steel. So what we see here is not niobium, but stainless steel jacket. This is the port from which liquid helium fills into the cavity, into the resonator. From here, it fills into the cavity. The total length of this resonator is around 0.5 meter. It will be actually 600 mm to be more precise. There are 4 ports, 4 openings. So these 2 lower openings are actually from where the beam charge particle enters into the resonator and leaves the resonator after acceleration. These 2 ports, one on this side and there is another one on the diagonal. These are known as the coupling ports. And one of them is used for coupling power into the resonator to excite it, to generate fields inside it, high voltages. And the other one is used for taking sampling small power out of the resonator to do measurements, to know what is the field that is existing inside the resonator. And as the name suggests, quarter wave resonators are basically electrical resonant circuits, electrical resonators which operate at a frequency of 97 megahertz. Now, this particular structure is made up of niobium metal from the inside, and the outside is surrounded by a stainless steel jacket. Now, niobium is a superconducting material and it becomes superconducting at 9.2 Kelvin. 9.2 Kelvin translates to -263.8 degrees. So when you cool down the niobium metal to -263.8 degrees centigrade, it becomes superconducting. So these resonators are actually cooled with liquid helium, which has a boiling point of 4.2 Kelvin. 4.2 Kelvin translates -268.8 degrees centigrade. So these resonators are cooled to a temperature of -268.8 degrees centigrade, and hence they become superconducting. When they become superconducting, the benefit of using superconductivity is the tremendous power saving. The typical voltages at which these resonators operate, the accelerating voltage is of the order of 320 kilovolts, that is 320,000 volts. That is the voltage that is generated inside each of these devices, resonators. Now, if we want to generate the same voltage, and in the superconducting state, these resonators, they require 4 to 5 watts of power only to generate such a high voltage. However, if we operate them in the normal conducting mode, for example, let us say we have a copper cavity, which is not a superconductor, and which operates in a normal mode, then to generate the same amount of voltage to accelerate, we will require powers of the order of 40 to 50 kilowatts. So you can see the tremendous advantage we have in terms of power savings when we use superconductivity.
The HCI comprises of 18 gigahertz high temperature superconducting electron cyclotron resonance ion source. There is a multi-harmonic puncher after this radio frequency quadrupole operating at 48.5 megahertz. Spiral puncher, which is again operating at 48.5 megahertz. And after this, there are six interdigital H-mode type drift tube linear accelerators, cavities to accelerate the ions. The high current injector is designed to accelerate almost all the ions right from the beginning, hydrogen to the iodine, especially including the noble gases and metallic ions having a mass to charge ratio less than or equal to 6. The high current injector can accelerate up to the 6% of the velocity of light with higher current capacity. The current capacity is about 10 particle nanoampere. This current capacity is due to the multiple step ionization in the ion source, and which is very useful for the low cross-section reactions, especially for the nuclear physics experiment. Now, we'll talk about the different elements involved in HCI. So first I will talk about the ECR ion source. The ECR ion source provides the ions having energy of 8 keV per nucleon. And this provides the DC current, direct current, which is further bunched by the multi-harmonic buncher. And this bunched beam further will go to the radio frequency quadrupole. The radio frequency quadrupole is a kind of RF linear accelerator, and it has a four rod electrode having a length of 2.5 meter and the bore diameter is about 12 millimeter. This can accelerate, this is basically designed to accelerate the ions from 8 keV to 180 keV per nucleon. Let us come to the six drift tube linear accelerators. These are all normal temperature RF structure, and this is basically the multi-RF gap structure. It comprises multiple gaps, multiple drift tubes separated by the RF gap. This whole structure will provide the energy gain from 180 kV per nucleon to 1.8 MeV per nucleon. There are various diagnostic components are installed in the beamline at the different places. The diagnostic components, maybe the Faraday cup, beam profile monitors, and others. So Faraday cup is basically used to measure the beam current, and beam profile monitors is used to measure the beam profiles at basically at the different locations in the beamline. Now we'll understand by taking one example. So suppose we are taking the silver ion. Silver has a mass of 107, and the HCI has a capability of producing the ions having energy is, you know, the 1.8 MeV per nucleon. And if you multiply the mass of the silver, that is 107, you will get the energy that is 192.6 million electron volt. So for silver ion, output energy of the silver ion is 192.6 million electron volt. And now this beam will go to the existing superconducting linear accelerator. At IUC that we are running two parallel accelerator simultaneously. One is the Pelotron and another one is the high current injector. So that's the beauty about this accelerator at IUSA along with the other accelerator. Thank you very much.
The material science experiments are done in three beam lines. Two of the beam lines are in the beam hall one, and this is the third beam line which you see here. So some of the conventional experiments we do in the beam hall one, where the radiation, general irradiation experiments at room temperature, liquid nitrogen temperature, and elevated temperatures are done. The irradiations for low fluence are also done there. We have three chambers in this beam line, and two are very highly specialized chambers in which I will just give you in a few minutes. But initially, I will show you this chamber. This is the conventional chamber where we do most of the irradiation experiments. This has, as you can see from the top, you have a sample ladder from which the samples are mounted. And at a time, you can mount up to around 24 or so samples at a time, and then irradiation can be done. The beams come from that side, that is the accelerator is on that side, and then the samples are irradiated here. What you see here is, this is a standard X-ray diffractometer. What is done here, this XRD, this is basically done for, it is one of the fundamental techniques for doing this characterization of samples, where you can see the correct this crystallization of the sample or its compound. This works on a very simple principle. What you have is there, what you see there is an X-ray source. The X-ray comes and falls here. There's a, some sort of a sample holder on which you mount your sample. This is mounted here. And then this X-rays are scattered, and this is the detector from where you get the diffraction pattern. And from the diffraction pattern, you see this is a standard formula, 2D sine theta is equal to n lambda. You can get this spacing between different planes, and that gives you this, what is the constant D, and you can get this idea of the element there. This is a standard system, but what we have done here is, as you can see, this accelerator beam is coming here, and then you can bring this chamber down, and this is connected to the beam. And then what we have is an in situ setup. What you do here is, like in the earlier chambers, you will have to take out the samples before doing this characterization in XRD. Here you can do it while the sample is still mounted there. So you are doing, you can increase the fluence, you can increase the irradiation time without having to change the sample in between or having to take it out. So that makes this a very unique facility, because now you are not having the sample to sample variation. This type of setup makes it a very versatile, where you can do a lot of experiments which are not possible in any other. So this is a Raman system. And so this is based on the Raman scattering system. You must have heard Dr. C.V. Raman got a Nobel Prize for discovering this Raman scattering effect. So this is also one of the very conventional methods for doing this analysis of the mostly molecular elements. This is based on the system that a laser falls on your sample and energy is taken from that photon, and that shift is what you measure, which is called the Raman shift. So typically there is a this is the vibrational band which takes the energy, and then this energy lowers. So this is what is used for this, getting again information about the elements of your sample and this their state. What is unique now, if you look at on this side, this is the beam line coming. So this is our accelerator beam line, from which accelerated beam through LINAC is coming, and then we have a chamber. So what is unique now here is that when the beam falls on the sample, there you see this chamber, which is a half cut chamber. So this is a specially designed chamber. So the beam goes inside and then falls on your sample, and then you have this collector. So you have, this is a half cut so that you can take the probe very near, and whatever signal is there, it comes through an optical fiber, and then it is fed into this Raman system. So again, this is a unique system, because you are doing this Raman without having to take out the sample from the vacuum. So the beam is falling on your sample and you can do the Raman while the beam is falling. So you can increase the irradiation without having to take the sample out and do the Raman measurement. So there are three chambers. First one we called Raman, in situ Raman, then a standard irradiation chamber, and the last one was the in situ XRD system.
The setup that you see here is the Indian National Gamma Array. It's a setup of gamma detectors. And in this setup, we study nuclei which are rotating at very high angular velocities, typically about 10 power 21 per second. In this, inside the scattering chamber, we keep the target material, which are bombarded by very heavy energy ion beams from the accelerator. And some of them, when they are above the Coulomb barrier, they fuse with the target nuclei. And we get a compound nuclei, which is formed at very high excitation energy and high angular momentum. This compound nuclei then decays by several protons or neutrons or alpha particles, and then it cools down. Once it cools down, it still has a lot of angular momentum and then some excitation energy, which further it cools down by emission of cascade of gamma rays. So it typically about 40 to 50 gamma rays are emitted in one cascade. And the aim of this detector array is to collect these gamma rays as efficiently as possible with high energy and time resolution. So this array, these detectors that you see are made up of high purity germanium crystals, and these have very high energy resolution. Now the gamma rays interact with these crystals through three basic processes: the photoelectric effect, the Compton scattering, and the pair production. In Compton scattering, most of the gamma rays only partially deposit the energy, and this causes a huge background in the gamma spectrum. To suppress this huge background, we use detectors which are surrounding the germanium detectors, which are called the anti-Compton shields. This improves the peak to total of the gamma spectrum. Now, what do we study? Once we see these gamma rays, we study various properties of these gamma rays, like their intensity, their correlation, their angular intensity distribution, and linear polarization. From these, we decipher about the quantum states inside the decaying nucleus. From these quantum states, we decipher about the various modes of excitation or de-excitation of the nucleus. And from that, we decipher about the properties of the nucleus. Now, when the nucleus decays and has a very high angular momentum, it tries to accommodate this angular momentum in various possible ways. It tries to change its shape, and the internal configuration of the nucleus changes a lot. So by studying the properties of the gamma rays, we could decipher about the shapes of the nucleus. So that's the basic aim. And from that, when the shape changes, there are very large changes happening inside the nucleus, and we come to know about the properties of the nuclei. Apart from the fundamental aspect, the gamma rays detector, the techniques of gamma ray spectroscopy can also be used for societal benefits. These are used, for example, in homeland securities and medical imaging, as well as trace elements of certain pollutants can be found out from soil and water using these techniques of gamma ray spectroscopy. So that's all. Thank you.
There are about 300 nuclei which are stable and which are available in nature, whereas there are several thousand, like about 7,000 nuclei, which are unstable, which don't exist in nature. So the only way to study the properties of these nuclei is to produce them in the laboratory, and then within the fleeting short time that it remains before it decays, the properties have to be studied. Hybrid recoil mass analyzer, which is just behind me. So if you take a molecule, the atoms are bound in a molecule with a very small energy, whereas the protons and neutrons inside a nucleus are bound by million times more energy. In addition, if you want to study the reaction, nuclear reaction between any two nuclei, then you have to overcome the repulsion between the protons in the two nuclei. In order to study this nucleus, we take already studied light nuclei, whose structure and properties are known, which are stable. We accelerated them to large energies, and then we bombard the species of the target nuclei, which is taken in the form of a foil or gas, and some of which will undergo nuclear reaction. The reason is the atom is mostly hollow, and the nucleus occupies a very tiny volume inside the atom. And the nuclei which we accelerate using large accelerator systems and bombard the target nuclei, they will go through hollow spaces. And only on few occasions, they will come close enough in order to feel the nuclear force, which is strong and attractive, which operates only at a femtometer distance, 10 to the minus 15 meters or so. And the strong attractive nuclear force can cause nuclei to undergo fusion or transfer or fusion fission. So the transfer reaction is nothing but exchange of some protons and neutrons between the projectile, which is accelerated with the accelerator, and the target, which is taken in the form of a gas or a thin foil in the reaction chamber. And fusion is nothing but the complete fusing of the projectile and target nucleus to form a very heavy nucleus, which doesn't exist in nature, and which is hot and excited nucleus, and which can have a large amount of angular momentum also. So when we go to heavy systems, the fission is a very competing channel, and more often than not, the fused nucleus fissions in a very short time scale of the order of 10 power minus 20 or minus 21 seconds. So very few nuclei will exist in the fused heavy nuclear form, and these are hard to detect because the fusion reaction is the most difficult reaction in the sense that the projectile brings a certain amount of momentum, it fuses with the target nucleus, and then the compound nucleus, which is thus formed due to momentum conservation, moves in the forward direction. Now, the probability of making this fusion reaction is very small. As I told you, the nucleus or the cross-section of a nucleus is very small compared to the atomic cross-section. So the fusion probability is very small. And in case it fuses, the compound nucleus can have a large angular momentum also. So we have this hybrid recoil mass analyzer, which is a dual stage, dual mode spectrometer. The first part of it starts from here. Inside this gamma chamber, there's a gamma array. There is a tiny vacuum chamber in which the target is put in the form of a foil, and the reaction takes place there. And the beam species, the accelerated beam particles, which are like trillion times more or a billion times more than the fusion reaction products, they all move together in the forward direction. So the background makes the biggest problem. And this electromagnetic device, the two stages, if we put together, it has electrostatic and magnetic dipoles for bending and for momentum and energy separation or dispersion. And we have large quadrupoles for focusing to increase the efficiency of the particles. And if we use the complete hybrid recoil mass analyzer, HIRA, which is two stages, both in vacuum, then we can carry out certain other reactions or fusion reactions in some other mass region in a different mode.
Dear students, let me introduce myself. My name is Sanish. So today I'm going to give you a brief description about the neutron detector array at IUAC. So this array is called a National Array of Neutron Detectors. This is the largest neutron detector array in our country and one of the few such facilities in the world. So let me divide this discussion into two parts. Initially, or in the first part, we will tell about the features of the array, structure and detectors involved, etc. And then the research program that we carry out using this multi-detector array will be discussed. So this array consists of 100 organic liquid scintillators mounted on this geodesic dome structure truncated at the bottom. And these detectors, like you can see, these detectors are mounted at well-defined or well-known spherical polar coordinates, theta and phi. And they are intended to detect fast neutrons coming from nuclear reactions. So two things we need to specify. Fast means how fast these neutrons are. And second thing, from where these neutrons are coming. This the energy of neutrons we expect here in the with the beam energies available at IUAC for this kind of reactions ranges from fractions of million electron volt, or in short MeV, to tens of MeV. So this is the typical energy range we deal with, the energy range of neutrons we expected in this kind of reactions. This fast neutrons, like one MeV neutron will take maybe 0.25 to 0.3 seconds. So they are that fast. Now from where these neutrons are coming? These neutrons are coming from the nuclear reaction that we conduct here. So for this, we mount nuclear targets and at the center of this chamber. This is a vacuum chamber for mounting our nuclear targets and other charged particle detectors, like a fission detector or light charge particle detectors. And then the energetic beam from our accelerator, Pellatron alone, or sometimes Pellatron plus LINAC, that energetic beams we transport through the beamline and bombard onto the target. And we make the reaction to happen. And these particles, neutrons or gamma rays or other light charge particles, these all particles will be emitted during this collision process. And these detectors are used for catching maximum of such neutrons. Now, how we detect neutron? The detection principle is very simple. This is elastic scattering. In elastic scattering, we know when the masses of the colliding partners are same or similar, then we can attain maximum energy transfer. So with this, based on this, we select our detection medium such that the mass of the constituent element should be or nearly is equal to the mass of neutron. So hence we select organic materials or organic compounds for the detection of fast neutrons as they contain hydrogen. This is one such detector. These all detectors are identical replicas. One fantastic property or one of the fantastic features of the detector is that they are sensitive to the kind of particle causing excitation. Or in other words, if the detector is illuminated with a neutron, then it shows one kind of signal compared to gamma. That means the detector signal, the output of a detector is a function or is a function of the kind of particle causing excitation. So we can exploit or we can utilize this feature to identify neutrons from other radiation background. That is very specific about organic liquid scintillators. So various institutes and universities in the country are part of this research program. And I hope to see some of you also coming in future to utilize this facility. Thank you.
Hello, friends. My name is Sunil Ojha. Here, I will be demonstrating you one of the Van de Graaff accelerator that we have at IUAC. This machine can go up to 1.7 million volt and it is a horizontal machine. Using this machine, we accelerate helium ions to do Rutherford backscattering spectrometry. This accelerator is used to perform same experiment which Rutherford and his group performed 110 years ago. I hope you all remember that Rutherford and his group used a thin foil of gold like this, and they shot helium ions on this. To their surprise, what they saw, some of the helium or alphas came back. Using this experiment, we understand that atom is a hollow structure and whole its mass is basically concentrated on a small point called nucleus. So when this alpha goes very close to nucleus, they come back. And we can measure the energy of these alphas and know the constituent of the sample under observation. Let's see how this accelerator works. Here we have ion source, where we generate negative helium by first generating plasmas and then converting the plasma of helium into negative ions. These negative helium ions are then accelerated using this accelerator. Here inside, we have high potential of 1 million volt. The stripper and high voltage is inside this tank. After stripping, helium ions are once again accelerated and the helium ions are then shot into the samples which are kept inside this chamber. A detector which is kept at a backscattering angle measures the energy of the backscattering helium. And because of that, we can get a spectrum which looks like this. Here we have plotted energy versus count of backscattered helium. Using this experiment, we can know the thickness of thin films or the composition of the films or the material under observation. Like if you see, this is the plot of a thin gold foil on silicon. And here we have an oxide of zirconium on a carbon. Thank you.
Hello friends. I am going to explain accelerator mass spectrometry facility at our center. So let us understand what is accelerator mass spectrometry. Accelerator mass spectrometry is basically mass spectrometry using an accelerator. So what is mass spectrometry? Mass spectrometry is a technique by which you can identify atoms or different molecules in a sample on the basis of their masses. So if you use accelerator for this purpose, then it is called accelerator mass spectrometry. Using an accelerator for mass spectrometry improve its sensitivity. Sensitivity of accelerator mass spectrometry is of the order of 10 to the power minus 16. What does it mean? It means that if you are going to identify one atom out of 10 to the power 16 atom, you can identify using this technique. Having such ultra high sensitivity makes this technique enable to measure long lived cosmogenic radionuclides which are present in very low abundances in the local natural environment. Example of such radionuclides are 14 carbon, 10 beryllium, 26 aluminium, 36 chlorine, 129 iodine, etc. Most popular application of accelerator mass spectrometry technique is radiocarbon dating. So radiocarbon dating is a technique to measure age of old objects found in different excavations. Old objects such as woods, bones, charcoal, etc. Carbon has three isotopes, 12 carbon, 13 carbon, both are stable. 14 carbon is radioactive in nature. It decays with half-life of 5,730 years. When an organism is alive, all amount of all these three isotopes of carbon are in equilibrium with the atmosphere. But once an organism dies, amount of radiocarbon start decreasing because of its radioactive nature. One can measure remaining amount of radiocarbon in a sample. One can calculate the time period when that organism was died, or in simple words, he can calculate the age of that sample. Here I am showing you one block of wood. How much is the age of this? It is 48,000 years old. It is used as background sample in different radiocarbon lab. We have also measured this age of this sample in our lab using this our AMS system. So first we extract cellulose out of this wood sample, and the cellulose looks like this. And the cellulose is converted into graphite because our iron source accept the sample in the form of graphite. Graphite, it looks like this, very tiny amount, around 5 to 6 milligram. Now this graphite is loaded into tiny sample holder, which is also called cathode. Such 134 cathodes can be loaded in our ion sources. This source generates negative ions from this graphite sample, and we select negative ion of 12 carbon, 13 carbon, and 14 carbon using an injector magnet inside this box. These negative ions are attracted towards the positive potential present at the terminal of this accelerator. When these negative ions are passing through this terminal of accelerator, they are converted into positive ions by stripping some of their electron in an argon gas channel by stripping process. We select plus one charge state of 14 carbon, 12 carbon, 13 carbon using this analyzer magnet. Current of 12 carbon and 13 carbon are measured using two off-axis Faraday cup present here. 14 carbon is counted in this gas ionization detector. Finally, we take ratio of counts of 14 carbon and 12 carbon counts. And this ratio is converted into radiocarbon age of that sample. Thank you.
So this is high resolution secondary ion mass spectrometer. This is first of its kind in our country. And this is actually a large geometry secondary ion mass spectrometer with high mass and spatial resolution, and it also has high reproducibility. So there are a lot of questions about the evolution of Earth, and one of the question is this: that when the Earth was formed. So how to answer this question, how to know about when Earth was formed? So what we basically need to do is this, that we need to look for the rocks, which are very old rocks, and those are the rocks, they can answer this question. So inside, when the rock formation takes place, there is a mineral called zircon, and this is very, very robust mineral. It does not change or alter with the high temperature and high pressure, which are the condition when the earth formation takes place. So we need to look for this zircon mineral and do the zircon dating using this instrument. So what is there in the zircon? There is a uranium isotope inside zircon, and uranium is radioactive. Uranium 238 decays to lead 206, and uranium 235 decays to lead 207 with a different half-life. So basically, uranium act as a clock inside the mineral, which is very robust. When the outer rings of zircon takes place, they also carry the information about the formation of that particular rock. So zircon, the score of zircon will tell when the rock was formed, and the outer rings of zircon will tell the further processes which happened during the formation of rock. So by knowing the parent to daughter ratio of these radioisotopes and using Concordia diagram, we can find out the age of the rock. So what happens in this instrument, we take the zircon mineral and then keep it in this chamber, where the zircon mineral is hit by the beams which are coming from the ion source. There are two ion sources in this machine, cesium ion source and oxygen ion source. So when this mineral is hit by the primary beam, the isotopes of uranium and lead, they come out of the sample and then pass through the electrostatic and magnetic separators and finally reach at the detection system, where they are simultaneously counted. And the process is so precise that all other neighboring isobars and isotopes are separated out by these filters. So by knowing the ratio of parent to daughter of uranium and lead isotopes and using Concordia diagram, we can find out the age of zircon. This is one of the application of HRSIMS. There are many other applications in nuclear particle detection and material science. Thank you.
So we have come to an end of the virtual program for today, and I hope that all the participants have enjoyed the event. I leave the program with good memories for the day. I was told that more than 330 participants have registered today and attended the program, and besides that, more than 150 participants have watched the program on the YouTube. We have already started receiving likes, and we have received more than 100 likes on YouTube. So thank you for such a warm response. I have two announcements. I would like to remind everyone that the digital certificates will be emailed to individual participants on the registered email ID. And secondly, I'd also like to tell that if there is any feedback you would like to give about the program, it is the most welcome. And please use the mail ID which we have provided to you on the flyer of the program to kindly send your feedbacks, valuable feedbacks, to us. This will help us to improve the programs in the future. Please do mention your name and affiliation in your feedback. So with that, I thank you all and have a great day ahead. Mm-hmm.